The human figure in painting is the subject of an exhibition called Paint Made Flesh that originated at the Frist Center for the Visual Arts in Nashville and is now at the Phillips Collection in Washington, D.C. The show features works from the 1950s to today by 33 artists who offer an extraordinary variety in their depictions of the body, including Pablo Picasso, Willem de Kooning, Francis Bacon, Alice Neel, Eric Fischl, Jenny Saville, and American painter John Currin, one of the most recognized and lauded figurative artists working today, who is here in the flesh with us. Welcome to you. When you think about this history of figurative painting since the 50s, you look at the kind of things we're just talking about. I referred to a lot of variety. Do you see variety, or do you see some common themes or common threads?
Well, when I began to paint as a student, I was hostile to that tradition and tried to be a grand abstract painter like Pollock or de Kooning. And so I came toward this tradition kind of negatively, finding out that it was really the only thing I was good at and that my heart was in.
Why were you hostile to it? Let me stop you
because
there.
Because it wasn't the cool thing to do. It wasn't avant-garde. It wasn't progressive. And especially when you're a student, you're yearning to be like your heroes, like the greatest American artists, de Kooning, Pollock, Rothko, those people. And what happens is you find out that you're not as in control of what what you ought to do as you think. So I kind of drifted into becoming a figurative artist.
Do you remember what exactly happened when you realized that was the right path?
That it was somewhat embarrassing, but that it was easy and beautiful, and that I didn't feel angst. I actually felt joy rather than tremendous angst, and I realized that's the way an artist should feel when they paint.
You know, I read in an interview where you said, "I always felt insecure about being a figurative painter and about being an American painter." Is that what you meant?
Yeah. Because it's generally in the painting of the figure has always been a kind of European specialty, and the most gorgeous paintings are still the European ones, the great ones, the old ones, and sometimes it feels a bit, I could joke that it's a bit like being an American in a French cafe, in a Paris cafe, and you're trying to drink your coffee the same way the real Parisians are. Sometimes painting the figure and painting figurative paintings can feel a little bit like you're an imposter if you're an American.
Well, in this exhibition, are there people you look to? I mean, because as you say, there is of now a grand tradition. In this country,
yes.
There are Brits, this exhibition has people from all over. Are there people you look to as influences?
Well, actually, my first influence was de Kooning, when I was a teenager and I wanted to be a famous artist. And I still would count him as a major influence. I thought of him as an abstract artist in
those
days.
Yeah, you mentioned him when you were talking about abstract.
Of course, in retrospect, he's a figurative artist. And actually, the apart from sort of high art painters, I mean, I think American movies and illustration are the most fruitful influences for an American, and I think the American advertising illustration, for instance, is kind of fantastic when you look at it from an artistic point of view, it's pretty good. As figurative paintings, they're actually okay.
Uh-huh. And you look to them as your influences come from pop culture. Advertising, TV, pin-up girls, and
yeah.
Pornography included.
I mean, shamelessly ripping it off, if that's counted as an influence.
Let's look at one we can show our audience. It's called The Hobo.
Yeah.
Now, what do I see here? Echoes of some of an older, even Renaissance tradition, which you obviously look to, but the pin-up style, the exaggerated features.
Well, I can't quite remember what the origin of the image was an old engraving, an old English engraving from the 18th century of a wandering hobo, and I guess I had been making these kind of Venus, these nude Venus paintings, and I wanted an image of a kind of Venus image that would be sort of halfway between the Never Never Land of a goddess and actual, you know, existence in the real world. And so I thought of this kind of wandering sexy hobo.
Yeah, sexy hobo, because this is not a hobo, clearly, right? We get a chuckle when we see this. This is your wife, right?
Well, it's her features. I think the face was from some amalgamation of magazine covers or something, but they always end up looking like my wife because her face is kind of always present in my imagination of an ideal woman.
You've also, we're talking about advertising and popular images. Pornography has been another thing you've made use of, right?
Yes.
From photographs? I mean, why does pornography, why do you turn that into art?
It wasn't like I had a grand strategy. It's partly the ubiquity of those images. You know, you just start to notice that some genres of pornography, the things that I found interesting, which was Danish, Scandinavian stuff in the 1970s. First of all, it's very unsexy. So
it's a very particular genre.
Yeah. Once you get over the sort of you know, hirsute nudity of everybody, it's they're actually pretty interesting pictures. And you realize there were probably a lot of frustrated artists photographing these things. The other thing was it spoke to me of a kind of lost world of as an American, my idea of a libertine Scandinavian socialist Europe, post-war Europe, a kind of paradise. When I was a little kid, I always thought Europeans were sort of all rich and all cultured and all lived in amazing houses with moldings and paintings In a funny way, that stuff, the Danish pornography, kind of evoked that. It plays on that, and it also was a way for me to acknowledge being an American painter rather than a European painter, because the subject matter is such a bombastic burlesque of what European life is.
I mean, it's interesting because so you're sort of using it almost in the same way you'd use an old master's painting, I guess, as a starting place or
a little bit like a tourist, or a little bit like I'm on my grand tour of Europe. I've always been self-conscious of my lack of elegance and grace, as in no matter how good I can paint, I lack the sort of aristocratic natural style of a European, and those things were these kind of movie stills from these ridiculous porn movies was a way of looking at Europe as a satirical way of looking at European images.
Tell me a little bit about process. Do you work typically from photographs, and then how much working and reworking? How long does it take to do a painting, for example?
Well, that's always been a kind of a sore point for me. Is I don't really have a method. I'd like to have a method, and whenever something turns out beautiful, I think, well, finally I know how to do it. The next painting I'm doing, I do just like that one, and it's going to take me 2 weeks, and it'll be easy. And of course, it never is, and it never works. The same thing never works twice. But generally, I have this mountain of clippings and faces that I like. Tear things out of newspapers. If I can get my wife to pose for me, I she does. I've started to still, you know, DVDs. You can still them and get the face interesting faces. So anywhere I can get them, and I also hire models and I've used the mirror when I have to and it's whatever works, whatever looks good in the end.
Let me finish where we started, coming back to this history of representational figurative painting. Where does it go? If you can look in your crystal ball a little, because every so often we hear about the, you know, the death of painting.
Yeah.
Then at other times we hear about the death of representation. Is there a future? What do you see?
Well, I mean, I hesitate to talk about the future of figurative painting because one of the things that I had to accept, and now I see as a kind of good thing about figurative painting, is that it was never particularly progressive. It never had the weight of say, the more severe modernist movements, which had to have a kind of progressive social message embedded in them. Mm-hmm. And one of the joys of figurative painting is that it's kind of hopelessly retrograde and reactionary, and it can't really carry a message about the future. And so that's not to say that it has no future, but one of the charming things about it is it doesn't really speak to the future, and it doesn't seem to have that burden, at least not emotionally, not for me. I think it's something that people love to do, and for that reason I think it'll never die. I think the thrill of making an illusion with colored pigments is too appealing for it to be completely supplanted by photography or video cameras or holography or whatever. It's fun and it's beautiful, and that's hard to keep that down.
All right, the exhibition is called Paint Made Flesh. John Currin, thanks for talking to us.
You're welcome.